So I'm not a self-defense guy, like, at all. I teach combat sports. I teach fighters how to win fights. But even so, no matter what kind of martial arts content you put up on the internet, people want to know, what about the streets? And one of the most common issues that comes up is, you should wear shoes on the streets. And if your shoes are not coming off in your training, and you are not training for that stipulation, then don't tell me you're training for the streets, because it's going to happen. It will happen. It will. It will. Did I mention it will happen? It's Ramsey Dewey and Xiao, and we're not in Shanghai, China. We're in Southern California right now, because it's where Xiao lives and it's where I'm visiting. And somebody on the internet told me that the laws of physics are not only different between China and America, thanks Dale Brown, but also that the laws of physics change dramatically whether you are fighting in the gym in gym clothes or on the street in street clothes. So you might notice we're wearing street clothes. So I got my shorts on, which is what I generally wear on the streets. I know it's also what I generally wear in the gym. I got a t-shirt on instead of a rash guard. And I've got a cowboy hat, because, you know, it's the streets and people sometimes wear hats.
Makes sense, because when you are on the street, you are constantly going to the gym.
That's true. In fact, a lot of the times, I'll actually be wearing a steel cup on the streets, because I'm like, well, might as well put it on now to save some time, and I go off to the gym. And we tested out like some Master Wong technique, and I'm wearing a steel cup, and everyone's like, you would never be wearing that on the streets. I'm like, well, that's not actually true. That's not actually true. Got my shoes on. This is kind of a big deal, because everyone's like, you need to wear shoes to practice fighting for the streets, because on the streets you wouldn't be barefoot, except I actually usually wear flip-flops.
How about motorcycle riders? They have a helmet and full body armor. Good luck fighting them without a weapon.
Yeah, that's going to be a game changer if you got helmets and stuff on, man. But let's talk about shoes for a minute. Our friend Dale Brown from Detroit Urban Survival Training, we tested out some of his techniques, and he said, hey, you're wearing shoes, because I think I had my Sambo shoes on, which are very different. They're thin, they're leather. They're nothing like a tennis shoe. Anyway, and he basically said, on the streets, you should be wearing shoes, so you should train in your shoes. Now, Xiao, I had an experience at the ultimate self-defense, what did we call that? Championship that Rokas from the Martial Arts Journey channel put on. It was me and Icy Mike and Sensei Seth and Jeff Chan and Matt from Reality Shack Self-Defense. And did I miss anyone? I think that's... And me, yeah. So we all fly down to Australia and do these self-defense-related competitions where we're scrapping around and playing out scenarios and whatnot. But I noticed, not just me, but in most of the combative scenarios, the shoes were coming off. And I think this surprised Mike, Icy Mike, the most, because he's like the self-defense guy. And he pays very close attention to his shoes, and he puts double knots in them and always gets like shoes that he can fight in. And so he thought he was pretty secure with the shoes. But in the very first combative thing where we're fighting on a bus, his shoes come off. My shoes come off. Multiple shoes come off. Matt, I think, was throwing my own shoes at me at one point. And then the next drill, we're like fighting dudes one-on-one, and shoes were coming off right and left. It was a really common occurrence.
Aww.
And it didn't matter how I tied them, these were coming off. So essentially, I'm either fighting barefoot or with a single shoe for a considerable amount of the time. So I tie my shoes with double knots. I have pretty secure shoes. Here, Xiao, pull on that thing. Pull. Oh, he's doing a straight ankle lock on me. You could probably rip that right off. Yeah, it actually, it's coming off.
There it goes.
So here he applied not even a lot of pressure, but it's already starting to come off. And this is a pretty typical tennis shoe. Xiao, can I borrow your shoe for a second? Let's see here. Yeah, that's coming right off. I mean, you pull on the heel, it slips right out. So.
Did it come off during grappling?
It came off during grappling, during striking, during pretty much all the time. All the time. So this is something like nobody talks about as far as real world for the street self-defense is shoes coming off. They just say, wear your shoes because it's a better weapon, which is arguably true. I mean, you can stomp harder and whatnot. less risk of injury to your foot.
Oblique kicks become OP.
Yeah, yeah. It makes certain kicks definitely overpowered.
Oblique kicks are uncheckable with shoes.
Yeah. So, but nobody talks about them coming off. How easy it is for a shoe to come off.
Maybe that's why military soldiers wore boots.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that actually makes a lot of sense. As combat boots come up to, you know, about right there, and they got laces, all kinds of laces. And, yeah, that makes sense. A boot, a combat boot, that is specifically built to stay on during combat. So, apparently, the militaries of this world have tested out different types of footwear to see which ones are ideal for battle. And it's not these. It's not the shoes most people wear on the streets. Should we put this to the test somehow?
Sure, why not?
All right, let's test out how sturdy average street footwear is in various combat scenarios against various combat techniques. Let's test out catching kicks and escaping from catching a kick. So, Zhao, go ahead and throw a kick at me, please. Hup. So I've caught his leg. He's trying to wrench his leg free.
Oh, my shoe!
The shoe came off. This is our first take. I didn't think it would come off during the first take.
I unironically believed I made a great escape until my shoe came off.
I think we just learned something. So if you wrench yourself free, there's a high probability your shoe's coming off. And if your shoe's not coming off, it's going to be a handle preventing you from wrenching yourself free. So if you have like super shoes or even combat boots we were talking about before, that won't come off, that's a great handle to grip your opponent with. Is it always advantageous to wear shoes in the streets?
Not always.
Not always. Yeah, I think we're busting some myths here today. Let's test it out against some other techniques. Heel hooks, anyone? Okay, so I'm minding my own business, you know, just sitting here chilling, and then a bad guy butt scoots up to me and decides to heel hook me. So there are a few options I've got. One, I can try to break this and push out there and try to pull this free. And as I'm doing that, yeah. Again, my securely tied, double knotted, standard tennis shoes that everybody wears, it came off. In that case, it actually made it easier to escape because he's holding my shoe, but not my foot. And so the shoe being bigger than the foot allows me to escape. So this is a double-edged sword. But now, since he's got my shoe, not only does he have a weapon in hand, I mean, let's think about this. Hold on. So my shoe just came off, but I managed to wrest it away from my attacker. So I now have a weapon, which is one bonus of wearing shoes on the streets, because perhaps we can use it as a weapon. The question is, how effective of a weapon is a shoe against an attacker?
More wrench.
I mean, I got a little heft behind it, just a little though. I got a little bit more reach, that's true.
Hitting with the side, that's smart.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, okay. Like that's like a slap. I mean, you might be able to get a knockout here, but that's got a little more heft to it. If this was a legitimate fight, how worried are you about the shoe versus maybe a fist or a kick?
It's not as bad as a stick.
Not as bad as a, that's true.
Stick, I should still be worried about it though.
It probably, you know, it might trigger PTSD, like if your mom used to beat you with a shoe for bad behavior and like, and shout your name and do that. Did your mom, I don't know if did your mom do this? My mom did. One syllable per spank while she's lecturing you. Don't you ever do that again. And then she'd call it your full name. And if you were the kid with the longest name in the whole family, oh man, you were screwed. So this could definitely trigger some PTSD. I can start screaming, don't you ever do that. So
fighting generally triggers PTSD.
Yeah.
In just about everyone, whatever they are traumatized by.
I don't think I could hit as hard with the shoe in hand as I can with my bare hand, but I also like my... I feel more comfortable with the shoe in hand because it's just like, it's something. Like,
save some damage from your hand.
Save some damage from the hand. That's Let's do some light contact shoe fighting.
Should I put on MMA gloves?
I need a very specific goal. My goal is like to grab you and carry you off screen.
Okay.
Or push you off screen.
So off screen is a few times I can't run.
Okay. So let's go. My hat. This is weird. I'm legitimately afraid of that shoe. More than the shoes on his feet, it's the shoe in his hand. Ah, he got me on the head. Okay. Okay. Well, that was something. I don't know. That changes the psychological thing. Like, it's not like the damage that you're scared of. It's just like...
It's a shoe. It's dirty.
You know what this reminds me of? So I used to live in Argentina, and they had all these wild, feral, mangy dogs with rabies running around all over the place. Like, just thousands of them everywhere. And this was a big problem. And so to get the dogs to go away, people would often throw rocks at them. And you didn't actually have to throw a rock at the dogs to make them leave you alone. You just had to pretend you're picking one up and then make like the motion at the dog, and then it would run away. So I feel like it's the same kind of thing. Like, the shoe isn't the best weapon in the world, but it's a weapon. And the fact that he brings it up and it's like, I'm coming at you, you're making this menacing motion, it creates this flinch response. Like, oh, I don't want to get hit by a weapon. That would suck. So there is that.
Also, I'm a lot more trained than the average shoe wielder on the street. So yeah. My Jeet Kune Do style meshes well with a melee weapon because it's fencing.
Oh, yeah, because I noticed you're jabbing with the shoe instead of swinging it. I think most people would swing with it, which I was like keeping distance with that shoe.
Yeah, because I have trained with melee weapons.
Yeah, that's interesting. Let's try another technique. And I want my shoe back. I'm a downed fighter. Xiao is standing over me. I got a pretty good guard. My jiu-jitsu is pretty decent. Maybe he's kicking, so I kick back. Maybe he catches one of my legs, which is a really common thing for people to do. And he starts pulling and... What? Okay. Let's break down what happened there. So, it is shocking how easy these come off. Like, that is shocking. Like, it's tight, it's double knotted, it's tight. So I got my guard, I'm kicking. Xiao's grabbing, which is a really common thing to do. I'm trying to pull my foot free. The shoe comes off, he throws it. I'm distracted because the shoe just came at my head and he passes my guard. Where else has this happened? This happened at the Ultimate Self-Defense Championship. I was sparring on the bus with our friend Matt from Reality Check Self-Defense. And we're not even going that hard at this moment. Under the seats, and I'm trying to push Matt away with my feet. He grabs the foot. The shoe comes right off. And I tied that with the best of intentions. And he throws the shoe at me, and it causes a flinch reflex, which makes me cover up and makes it really easy for him to pass the guard. So at that point, it's like this. If Xiao's on the ground, let's say this is an MMA fight, right? And one of the most successful guard passes in MMA, we have a hold of a foot. I telegraph a big wind-up punch right here, like just a big sloppy overhand, boom, to get him to flinch. And now I use that to start working the guard pass.
That's the shoe.
It's like shoe. The amalgam of the shoe. If I'm throwing this at him to get that flinch reflex, to get him to straighten out his legs, to get him to pull his arms in, to get him to do something wrong, boom. Same thing with that overhand. So shoes come off in street fights. Easily, often, and almost always. What do you think, Xiao?
Let's try your best to avoid street fights. That seems like the easier course.
Yes. You know what a street fight is? People often mistake a street fight for an aggravated assault. If some dude jumps out and attacks you, mugs you, stabs you, shoots you, beats you up, that's an aggravated assault. That's a crime. A street fight is two idiots who get mad at each other and they're like, oh, your girlfriend looks like the Lion King. And then he pushes me back and he's like, no, your girlfriend looks like the Lion King. And then
your girlfriend looks like a Ninja Turtle.
Oh, you did not. And then after the pushing match, they throw a couple of sloppy punches and then they grab each other in goofy schoolyard bully headlocks and they're like, I'll squeeze your head until you die. And then they get tired and fall on the ground. And They get tired and hope their friends pull them apart. That's the average street fight. Do you want to know how to win the average street fight? Just don't get in one, because it's dumb. It's dumb, and you're dumb if you're doing that. Thank you for watching. Now get out there and train.